See, I got to tell you, the 11 o'clock, you are more responsive than the 9. I just want to let you know that. But to be honest with you, I still think you could lift your game. Is that all right? So I want to maybe remind us of how I started this year, Full Wave Church, because I actually feel like the Holy Spirit inspired this thought that is the theme of our whole year, and that is don't lose your dance. And how that in all that's happening, you know, medically speaking, nationally speaking, globally speaking with COVID, and then, of course, all of the leading up to November with the election and all the challenges of just, you know, people just sitting on such polarized views. People say to me, America's been never been more divided in the history of the United States. And I'm going, do we not remember the Civil War? Like, I mean, you know, like to me, I just think sometimes we got short memories, but we have challenges. Are you hearing me? And I'm thinking, and then of course, then with some of the social injustice matters, and this month is Black History Month, and of course, we've got all the Black Lives Matter movement, which is what I want to talk mention of. And we got a lot of people with a lot of strong feelings on a lot of things. And if we're not careful, we could lose our way. Are you hearing me? And if we're not careful, we could actually suddenly have a point of view that actually isolates us from the very people that God's called our brother and sister. I'm convinced there are some Christians out there that are 100% convinced that if you are a Republican, that you cannot be a Christian. And I know people who think the same thing about Democrats. Are you hearing me? God, I've got to tell you something. Let's just go back to the Lord's Prayer. Our Father. He's not, God's not a Republican. God's not a Democrat. God's not even an American. And I'm, as the pastor, I'm wanting to bring what I believe, just this thought about don't lose your dance. And just make sure that we don't actually lose our dancing partners. Who are we going to dance with in life? And it's not just people who agree with us. Amen. And so this is the thought. Now, I'm not trying to be one way or the other, if you haven't noticed. I'm deliberately trying to get everybody to say, can we just figure out how to do life with each other? Amen. Amen. And so, you know, I was just thinking about this thought. I was not sharing, like, every year, every January, go away for 10 days. And we do genuinely want to seek God for Wave Church. We've already done most of our financial plans for the year and our budgets and our priorities and our hire for the next 12 months of who's going to be part of our team and the major ministry initiatives and the emphasis that we want to put out throughout the year, you know, our conferences, our themes of what we're going to preach in church. All of those things are finalized in those last 10 days, and those 10 days of every new year we go to pray. It's good to know, isn't it? We don't just repeat what we did last year. We don't just take last year's budget, cut and paste it. We actually really try to find God and put the financial appropriation and financial allocation and priority to the things we feel the Holy Spirit's leading us to in these 12 months. You got that? Okay, so we're on a sunset cruise. And Sharon and I, we didn't realize, we thought we were on a sunset cruise. But what we're actually on was a party boat. It was a booze boat. It was, and we were the only old people on the whole. I think there was one other couple, and they were sitting there shrunk in their little seat when they realized these are all college age people, and they were partying. Sharon and I were just sitting there. To tell you the truth, we didn't feel all that out of it. We kind of thought these are the very people God's called us to reach, and so it wasn't like some awkward moment for us. We were just loving it. Talking to these couples, and the very first conversation they're all having with each other, total strangers meeting each other on a party boat. I'm just laughing. I'm just like, isn't it funny that we're here to pray and find God, and God just reminds me again, this is who you're called to reach. And I'm sitting there going, God, how do I reach these people? So I watched this one couple. Long story cut short. There's this one couple who I noticed, there's always a leader in a group. Even if you get a total group of strangers, there's always a leader that, you know what I mean? Anywhere, trust me, anywhere. There's always a leader. And this one couple were really fun, and they were dancing like nobody. And they literally got everybody dancing. I'll never forget it. It reminded me of the time of the World Series when there was this one cheerleader in our section. It was the New York Mets versus the New York Yankees. And this one guy, a fan, got our whole section up shouting, "Let's go Mets." He was so good. He got the whole section. And it was the only game the Mets won in the World Series. I happened to be there. And so I was looking for leaders. I was looking, who can lead? And this couple, man, they had everybody up dancing. It was, and they were so much fun. But then we went to Margaritaville. I didn't know Margaritaville was on the Sunset Cruise stop, but it was. It was a big bar. Well, Cheryl and I didn't want to go to the bar, so we went to Burger King. And then we came back, and I'm thinking, we get back on the boat, I'm waiting for the party couple to get the party started. And but they were nowhere to be found. They were off around the side, and they were going at it, yelling. And these words come out of my mouth. Who's ever said something, and then when it comes out of your mouth, you go, that was a God moment. You just, like, that was a God insight. There was a God revelation. And I said to Sharon, I said, hey, they lost their dance. And as those words came out of my mouth, I felt the Holy Spirit say, make sure Wave Church doesn't lose its dance. Make sure with everything I just talked about, and make sure with everything that's going on in our nation that we as a church with COVID, the uncertainties of health and the economy and all that's going on, that we don't lose our dance. The Bible says David danced before the Lord. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes, there's a time to dance and there's a time to mourn. Well, there's nothing worse if it's a time of dancing if you're mourning. And there's nothing more inappropriate than if you're, you know, if it's a time to be mourning and you're dancing. There's a time, and I believe the word of the Lord for Wade Church is let's not lose our dance. The Bible says that Miriam danced, watch this, it says in Exodus 15, then Miriam, the prophet, Aaron's sister, for all the male chauvinistic pigs that think there's no room for women to be in leadership. Miriam, the prophet, amen, Aaron's sister, there's no gender confusion here. This is a woman. She took the timbrel in her hand and all the women followed her with timbrels and were dancing. And the Bible says they danced with all their might and they were dancing and they were singing, I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and rider are thrown into the sea. God swallowed up Pharaoh and all of Pharaoh's men and drowned them. And Miriam goes down to the edge of the Red Sea. She's dancing in the shallows of the Red Sea and she's dancing on the grave of our enemies, because they're no longer slaves to Egypt. They're no longer oppressed. God is leading them out. I got to tell you something. When you never lose the wonder what God has done for you, you still got some dance. If you actually aren't able to dance anymore, you may just want to remind yourself that you were taken out of Egypt, out of slavery, out of the bondage of sin, out of a Christless bound eternity, and now you've been brought in to God's kingdom. So I was thinking this morning, what would I share with you as I close out this series? And this is the first thought. And I actually felt the Holy Spirit have me repeat this. And I want to give it to you this way. Too many of us want to go back at the first sign things get hard. Too many of us want to go back at the first sign things get hard. If it was easy, everybody would be doing it. Are you hearing me? So let me just show you, and this is the thought I want to give you. Don't settle for less than God's best. God wanted Israel out of Egypt. He didn't want his people to live oppressed and under bondage and slavery. God wanted the very best for his people. Amen? But as we read, as God brings them out of Egypt into the promised land, they're going through some hard times. And this is the thought. Too many of us give up at the first sign of a hard time. Now this is after, watch this, the flies, the locusts, the plagues, the boils, the firstborn son, child dead, the river of blood, the frogs. Frogs everywhere. You wake up in the morning, there's frogs everywhere. Here a frog, there a frog, everywhere a frog. Old MacDonald had a frog. Are you hearing me? I mean, these are God afflicting Egypt because Pharaoh wouldn't let God's people go. You catching it? And look what the Bible says, Exodus. Exodus means exit. They're leaving. They're getting out. They're on a journey. They're going into the promised land. How many have, thank God, you've exited the kingdom of darkness? How many thank God that you're no longer under the power of the enemy? How many thank God your eyes are open to the truth? Come on, somebody. And it says here now, as Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them. They were terrified and they cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us out here in the desert to die? What is it you've done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, 'Leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians'? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert." Then Moses answered the people, "Don't be afraid, stand firm, and you will see the deliverance of the Lord." Can I tell you something? They had just gone through the Red Sea. They just saw God swallow up. They just actually were going to the Red Sea. And God, they just saw God, the angel of death, wipe out all the firstborn children in Egypt. They saw the frogs. They saw the locusts. They saw the hand of the Lord. They saw the Red Sea. Listen to this. Right after this account, they saw the Red Sea open up and swallow Pharaoh. Yeah. And here they are saying to Moses, isn't it funny how when people go through tough times, they always blame leaders? Isn't it funny? And it was Moses. And listen to the complaints. It says, "Were there no graves in Egypt? What have you done to us? Leave us alone. Let us serve the Egyptians. It would have been better for us." First sign, things get tough. People start negative. Look what it says here in Exodus 15. When they came to Marah, this is now they've gone through the Red Sea. They couldn't drink its water because it was bitter. And that's why the place is called Marah. So the people grumbled against who? Moses, saying, "You know, what are we to drink?" Then Moses cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a piece of wood. He threw it into the water. The water became fit to drink. 3 days later, the Bible says, there's no water, and the water they found was bitter. And they were grumbling. Could you imagine being Moses? Could you imagine for a minute what it would be like to be this leader that God's called you to? You know, Moses didn't even want to do this in the first place. Are you hearing me? And finally, Moses steps up to be the man of the hour. And here are the people that you're trying to lead under the hand of God, and the people are complaining. Look what it says. I love it. It says in Exodus 16, in the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate food, all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death." They actually think that Moses' leadership is the problem. They didn't realize it was Moses' leadership that was taking them into the promised land. They said, "If only we died in Egypt." They said, "There in Egypt, there was plenty of meat. There were plenty of pots. There was lots for us." Really? Can I show you what it was like for them? Come back to Exodus chapter 1. It says, "Come," it says, this is Pharaoh, "we must deal shrewdly with them, or they will become even more numerous. And if war breaks out, we'll join our enemies, fight against us, and leave the country." Here's Pharaoh, he's figuring out. These people, these Israelites, they're breeding like flies. And they're going to outnumber us soon. And if we're not careful, they join our enemy, and then we will no longer have Israel as our slaves. So look what they do. This is the children of Israel just said, "We're better off back here." The children of Israel said, "We had more food, we had a better life than where God was taking them." Do you imagine being Moses? Who would like to lead this motley crew? 3 million of them. Now look what happens here. I love it. It says, come back now. It says in Exodus chapter 1, it says, "So they put slave masters over them," watch, "to oppress them with forced labor. And they built Pithon and Ramesses as store cities for Pharaoh." Matter of fact, I don't have time to show it to you, but the Bible says they halved the amount of food they gave them so as they'd be even more emaciated. And it says they doubled the work hours. But isn't it funny how the children of Israel remember it? "Oh, it was so much better back there in slavery." I meet some Christians and go, "Man, I was better off before I was a Christian." Really? When you were lost, directionless, no purpose? See, the first time things get hard, we got to be careful we don't lose our dance. You see, they were losing their dance. Here's the second thing. Dancing means taking ground. Dancing means moving forwards. It's not just looking back and lamenting over the past. When you do that, you'll lose your dance. But dancing actually means you're taking ground. You don't long to go back, but you look forwards. Hebrews chapter 12, one of my favorite Bible verses. Fixing our eyes on Jesus. That was absolutely terrible. Fixing our eyes on Jesus. Oh, let me read it. Fixing our eyes on CNN. Fixing our eyes on Fox News. Okay, fixing our eyes on Bitcoin. Fixing our eyes on NASDAQ. Fixing our eyes on the unemployment numbers. Fixing our eyes on the amount of COVID deaths. Fixing our eyes on the amount of vaccinations. Is that what it says? Come on, is that what it says? Fixing our eyes on the economy. No. Fixing our eyes on I think you could say that name a whole lot better than you just said it. Come on, online, can you help me? Fixing our eyes on
Jesus.
Amen. Not on the Republican Party, not on the Democratic Party. God's not a Republican, God's not a Democrat. God's not even American. Fixing our eyes on who is the author and the finisher of your faith? Where does faith come from? By fixing your eyes on Jesus. And I'm hearing a whole lot of talk and a whole lot of conversation of people who are fixing their eyes other than Jesus. And I'm hearing a lowering and seeing a lowering of our faith. But I want to tell you where faith comes from. It's by fixing your eyes on Jesus, who still is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. When one king thought he was all that and a bag of chips in the Old Testament, he got filled with his own arrogance and prominence. Let me tell you, God sent him insane for 7 years until he humbled himself and acknowledged that God is sovereign. God is not worried. Oh, no, I still got some work to do to help you, church. Don't misunderstand me. Everybody's entitled to their view. But I don't believe for a second that this country or the world is at the mercy of people. God is not going, oh, no, every plan I have for the entire salvation of the world is ruined by this outcome. Okay, still got some work to do. Okay, look at the Bible says, fixing your eyes on Jesus, who for the joy that was what? Set before him. What was set before him? The joy. Hey, look into the future. Look into the future. What was the joy that was set before him? It was the cross. Knowing that if he went to the cross, it would bring salvation for all of mankind. My question is, what if he was looking at just the cross? The most tormentuous death known to mankind. The most agonizing, wrong, illegal, illegitimate court process. That would actually be one of the most barbaric, sadistic ways in which someone could be killed. But no, Jesus, the Bible says, we fix our eyes on Jesus, who for the joy that was set before him, Jesus was forward looking, but he had a joy that was set before him because he saw beyond the cross. And he saw as a result of him going to the cross that it would bring salvation, forgiveness of sins, healing, restore marriages. Come on, somebody. Anybody hearing me? So I want to encourage you. We got to make sure that our eyes are fixed on Jesus. Listen to this. Who is the author and the perfecter and the finisher of your faith. And we're forward looking. We're looking past just what's the temporal, but we're looking into what will be the eternal. And look what the Bible says about Jesus. Watch this. It says, and at that time, Jesus in Luke chapter 10, full of joy, through the Holy Spirit said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned and revealed them to the little. Yes, Father, for this is what you are pleased to do. I don't have time to give you all the verses preceding it, but the Bible says this, that right before Jesus said that, he says, behold, I saw Satan fall from heaven and fall down as lightning and destroyed. And as a result of it, the Bible says Jesus filled with joy. So my friend Robert Cameron said, Steve, did you know that word filled with joy actually in the Greek means a Galileo? and I'm probably not saying it how I'm supposed to, Robert, but it means to jump for joy. It means to be exceedingly glad. It means to rejoice greatly. In other words, who's ever had something happen where you were so thrilled that you jumped for joy? Anybody ever had that? It's like, you know, just suddenly you go, yes! Who's ever done that? You're just like, all of a sudden you hear something and you're just filled with joy. Yeah. The Bible talks about when Mary and Elizabeth, and they were both pregnant with John the Baptist and Jesus, the Bible says that when they came into the same room, these babies in there, and they, it says they leapt in their mother's womb. There's something that the Holy Spirit does that causes you to have a yes. And I'm just saying, church, we can't lose our jump. We can't lose our joy. Come on, somebody. We can't lose our dance. Look at this verse, Acts chapter 3. Now, Peter and John went up together to the temple for the hour of prayer. It was the ninth hour. And a certain man who was lame from his mother's womb was carried. And they laid him daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful. And he would ask for alms, and who entered the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked for alms. And fixing his eyes on him, with John, Peter said, look at us. So the man gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, silver and gold have I none. Well, imagine how he felt. Darn it. I thought I was going to get a few dollars. Silver and gold have I none. Come up here, Robert. All the praise team, come up here for a minute. But such as I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk. He took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately, everybody say immediately, his feet and his ankle bones both received strength. So he was leaping, the Bible says. He stood up and he walked, and he entered the temple, and he was walking and leaping and praising God. The Bible says, watch this, he had an expectation of money, but Peter said, I don't got any money, but I do have something. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And he was walking and leaping and praising God. Are you ready, Rob?
Yep.
Come on, church, stand to your feet. Everybody online, we're going to sing the song.
Silver and gold have I none.
Watch this.
But such as I have give by thee. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Do we have the words?
Of Nazareth, rise up and walk.
Here we go.
They
he was walking and leaping
and praising God.
He was walking and leaping
and praising God.
Come on.
In the name of Jesus Christ. Of yeah. Nazareth, rise up and walk. They were walking
and leaping.
God, walking and leaping and praising God in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk.
Come on,
yeah.
Come on, walking. Show it to me, David. He was walking and leaping. Some of you, if you've been touched by God, you got something to dance about. You can be seated. And here's the last thought. Come on. Don't turn back the first time things get hard. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Listen to this. Dancing means you're taking ground. Before, the man was just laying there. But one touch and all of a sudden he's leaping. The Bible says Jesus, he wasn't just walking, he was leaping. Amen. There was, and I'm praying today, some of us, we don't just walk out of here, but we leap, we jump. We got some joy in us. Amen. We're going to get on top of this thing called COVID. We're going to get on top of this thing called what's happening in a nation. The church is, hey, I got to tell you something. I'm reading through this account in Exodus and I'm thinking, man, I tell you, it's a funny thing how sheep love to attack the shepherd. Are you hearing me? And I know sometimes sheep bite. Amen. And I realize my role as your shepherd is not to be like the people here that complain. My role is to intercede like Moses did for the sheep. Some of you got me interceding more than I've ever done before. Are you hearing me? Come on, we got to be part of the answer. Amen. And here's the last thought, real simple. It says here, and I want to give it to you, that actually one of the most important things we do is we don't lose our dance. I want to just show you this in Scripture. See, I mean, for instance, who's ever heard of a song that you go, that's my song? Who's ever thought about a song that brings back some memory that it just gets you kind of wanting to dance? In baseball, for instance, I love baseball. Baseball is my sport. Since I was 1963, I came out of the womb saying, let's go Mets. And I used to love back in the 60s going with my dad to the Shea Stadium. And I loved the seventh inning stretch. What I loved about it was, because after seven innings, you kind of get a little bit, you know, kind of like, oh man, you know, seven. Sharon, she loves going to the baseball with me, but she thinks it's probably seven innings too long. You hear me? So she's always going, when's the seventh inning? She's dying, waiting. Because the seventh inning, at least you get there, stand up and you stretch. And how many know the seventh inning song? Oh, yeah. How many of you know what it is? Give me a wave if you know what it is. Here it is. Listen to it. Come on, you got to sing it. Come on, buy me. Root for the Mets, for the New York Mets. But it'll be typical. Two, three strikes and you're out. All right, now, okay, so that brought back some memories. For me, that's what it did. It actually made, it brings back some fond memories. Or for instance, I guarantee you there's a song that everybody knows that brings back these feelings. Okay, I'll give an example. I'll show it to you. Ready? Are you going to help me out here? Watch this now. I just played the first part of the song. Tell me how many of you know it. How many? Come on, right away. Stop. How many already know where we're going with this song? Are you ready for it? Are you ready for it? I'm trying to get you to. I'm just trying to get. Hey, come on, don't lose your dance. Don't lose your song. Here we go.
Hands,
come on.
Touching hands.
You know the words.
Reaching out,
touching me, don't touch somebody else,
touching you,
come on everybody,
sweet Caroline, good times never seem so
come on,
good.
Come on, some of you, come on, boo, you're allowed to. Oh, that was some of you. I'm telling you, you're sitting there, you're so religious, you don't think you could even enjoy singing that song in church. You need to be set free of a religious spirit. Many are cold, but most are frozen. We're going to do it one more time, and you will get set free. Are you ready? Hit it again, everybody.
Hand,
come on. I need some worship leaders.
Touching hand,
come on.
Reaching out.
You can't help but to smile. Oh, yeah. Here we go.
Sweet Caroline.
There you are.
So good.
All right. Okay. That's good. Now, I'm going to do one more because now I got you finally smiling in church. Amen. You ready for this? I'm going to give you one more song. I guarantee you, this is how confident I am. I'm going to pick people out of the congregation to help you dance this song. But I guarantee you, most of us, if not 90% of us, will know the moves to this song. And it actually requires some dancing, okay? Come on, Jim Mueller, I need you to help me here. Come on up here, Jim. I guarantee you. Okay, Josh Kelly, I need you up here. Sharon, come on up here, help us out here just to show the spirit of participation. Peggy, I need you. Come on, Peggy. Come on. I need you, Peggy. Come on. Come on over here, Peg. Over here by Sharon here. And I'm going to find just... Okay, are you ready for this? Are you ready? Oh, Peg, you know it. You'll find out in just a second. Okay,
Here we go. Are you ready, church? We're going to stand to our feet and we're going to sing it. Are you ready? Hit it, Mr. Soundman. You know it. Do you know it, Pete? Now. Oh. No, 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 we're not done yet.
You can be seated.
You got to do something to get things moving in this church sometimes. I guess my thought is this. How many of you ever thought to yourself when you hear something come on the radio or you hear something come, music, whoever it comes, on iTunes, Alexa, how many of you think, that's my song? And the songs that bring a dance. And I'm thinking, what is the song of heaven? What is the song that gets us dancing? And here's my last thought as I close this message. Don't lose the dance of generosity. The Bible says heaven rejoices more over one person that gets right with God than over 99 righteous people. The Bible says this. Now David was told the Lord had blessed the house of Obed-Edom and everything he has because of the ark of the Lord. So David went to bring the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David. Watch this. With rejoicing. When those who were carrying the ark and they were carrying the ark of the Lord, had taken six steps. He sacrificed a bull and a fatted calf. They gave an offering. Every six steps. With rejoicing. The Bible says Jesus leapt. The Bible says that this man who was touched by the Lord, when Peter prayed for him, he was leaping and jumping and praising God. When you've been touched by the presence of God, you've got something to dance about. When was the last time you danced? Amen. And the Bible talks about when they were dancing, every six steps, they gave an offering. And the Bible says David was dancing before the Lord with all his might, while he and all the Israelites were bringing the ark of the Lord with shouts of joy. Here's my question. Have you still got the dance of generosity? Do you know, in this season of COVID, I'm not a guy that carries a lot of cash. I'm not. I just like having a credit card with a paper trail. But I've been very intentional in these last 12 months to make sure I've got cash on me. And when I stay in a hotel, as much as the service has gone down, and I'll be honest with you, it has gone down. Anybody travels know what I'm talking about? Boy, oh boy, I can't even get a banana for breakfast anymore. I mean, that sounds ridiculous to complain about it, but if you knew how much I like bananas. And I go, you mean, I'm staying at the JW Marriott, and I say to the waitress, I just want oatmeal and a banana, please. Well, we don't have any banana. I'm going, even 7-Eleven sells bananas. Are you hearing me? And I realize they're just glad to have a job. The hotel I stayed at was at a 10% occupancy. And this poor waitress doesn't need some arrogant, self-obsessed person to be mad about no bananas. So I just make sure I'm just given $20. Here's a tip. Thank you for just being here and serving. Are you hearing me? And I'm seeing a homeless person. I've never been more engaged and more deliberate. My own personal hairdresser that cuts my hair. And she's telling me how tough it's been for her. And I'm telling you, and every time I go there, I always make sure I've got a whole lot more than I would normally tip because I just want to say thank you and I understand this has not been easy for you. Do you still have the dance of generosity? With your words, with your time. Every six steps, that's my song. When it comes to offering at Wave Church, Do you still have the dance of generosity? Or are you getting tight? Oh, things are hard. No, no, no. The Bible says the world of the generous gets larger and larger. But the world of a stingy man gets stingier and stingier. I want to make sure if you squeeze me, what comes out of me is a dance. I want to make sure that if I've been touched by good and God's been good to me, I want to make sure I always remain on the side of faith and generosity. Can anybody say amen? Do you receive the word? Give a Lord a hand if you receive the word. I got to tell you, to be honest with you, a lot of my generosity now is by first not saying what I think. How do you know what I'm talking about? I'm thinking some things, and maybe the first step to generosity is not letting out of my mouth what I'm thinking, because I don't understand what this person's going through. I was at McDonald's one time for my daughter when she was a little girl. I just felt the Holy Spirit remind me to tell this story. And I remember I was in a big hurry, and I was with Alyssa. This is a long time ago. And I stood there and I looked at this person that was serving behind the counter. And to be honest with you, she looked pretty disheveled. She obviously had a whole day. She was on toward the end of a shift, and she was covered in McDonald's food, sauce, ketchup, mustard. Hair was all messed up. I actually noticed that one point she was leaning over to the fry machine. I looked and she had holes in the bottom of her shoes. And I'm standing there and there's only one person in front of me. And I'm getting mad because she's taking forever to serve this one person in front of me. Only to discover that this person in front of me was still waiting to be served themselves. And I was literally standing there for a good 10 minutes. And I'm thinking, what the heck is this girl doing? That she's not taking the order of the person in front of me. And finally, the person in front of me turned to me and says, I'm still waiting for that person to take my order. Well, I'm looking at my watch and I'm looking at her. And then I'm looking to see, where's the manager? And then I realized this poor girl was busy trying to do all the drive-thru orders. And that's a management problem in of itself. But that's got nothing to do with this as a human being that God loves. And I'm getting angrier by the minute. I'm ashamed to admit it. And at one point I thought, when she finally serves me, I'm going to give her, this girl, a piece of my mind. And the Holy Spirit said, yeah, you go ahead, Steve. You rip her. You look at her. You tell her how mad you are. You tell her that you are some big preacher. You're a big deal. Steve, look at her shoes. Now look at your shoes. How much did she pay for her shoes? What did you pay for yours? Steve, look at her uniform. Look how old and tired it is. Look at the clothes you're wearing. Tell me, Steve, what did you pay for your clothes? That girl, the Holy Spirit spoke to me, is a single mom. And she's got a job and she's doing everything she can to survive, to take care of her family. When she goes home, she doesn't even have another set of clothes to get changed into. You go ahead and tell her how mad you are with her because she's doing everything she can to keep her family fed. And you, who are so filled with your own sense of self-importance, the last thing she needs is someone like you to come along and push her over the edge. Go ahead, Steve. Tell her how mad you are. And I just stood there and wept. I said, oh God, I'm so sorry. Can I just say this to your church? Can we stay on the generous side? Can we keep generosity? Can we not lose our dance? Can we not get mad with people with long lines? Can we be better than the world? Can we be different than the world? Can we just be people who've got a dance? Can somebody say amen? I felt the Holy Spirit. Somebody needed to hear that. You're getting impatient with this world, and yet we're called to love this world. Walking and leaping and praising God. We are walking and we're leaping and we're praising God. Amen.